good. It looks good a little bit more. That was good. Chin up a little higher. A little higher still. Right there. Good. Alright. Alright. Here we go.
He has one.
A pencil or pen?
Okay.
It's got to come out of this knee board.
It's hard to tell whether it's the environmental lights or it's actually the payload station.
Excellent.
Oh,
just
somebody
one?
Just came in and
just
moved
one's
it,
fine.
Which was great.
There's another one if you need it. Just put that in a shoulder pocket.
Just for now, yeah.
Okay, you got it. And your car is good?
Yes, thanks.
Alright,
you got
your flight data
file?
Got you
loud and clear. Nice. I haven't seen that at all. It should be outside still.
Yes, we have both sitting on the table.
Alright, Rex, you're all ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, Juan, we are ready. Okay, you guys got it.
John's a little funny.
They can take one back to audit, right? What time do you need?
About a minute and a half, maybe 2 minutes.
That's it.
Push it.
All right, temperature feedback is like.
Take it back.
We see the 2234 on board. We'd also like you to pick up the payloads. You can restring at the Ops 3 transition per the cue card.
Matt, done.
All right. Thank you.
That was good so far, man. All right,
here's
it's
the
kind of nice.
Ops 3 one for is string 1 still down? String 1 is going to be his back down, down, Mike. Okay.
But when we had, you know, I had it before 126 and... I think I had good luck with them. I don't remember having issues with them. With this, or if they were, they were very much.
Yeah. it? It's all packed. Is that okay? You don't look like you.
You start to struggle with your feathers. Let me see if you can make the raft downwind from it.
We've also set up the airlock in a configuration that'd be used for either an EVA pre-breathe or shuttle oxygen and nitrogen transfer. So those actions in the joint emergency egress cue card are going to be valid. That is a coordination piece on the ISS side that needs to be taken care of in there. We can talk here in a few minutes on how you might want to coordinate that between you six.
I'm already, this is like general quarters on a ship, you know. Before the emergency actually occurs, you actually get all your safety equipment on and you're all ready to go.
It should be in the equalized position. You need to back it up to here, I believe. Cause PPR for the airlock. So.
G procedure, we finished 1.1, 1.2, and step 6, and 7.
Finished on delivery. 2.1 is complete and we're going to 2.8. And Houston, this is Atlanta. We have everybody on the space shuttle right now. We're actually step 10 of the joint emergency egress cue card, and we're going to hold before disconnecting the O2 lines for a status, but we did close the floor off.
You want to tell them?
We did.
I called it already.
And you're holding off on the
oxygen line. Figure out how many bottles you used. How much?
Copy
it,
Atlanta.
Copy
Atlanta.
LA deck 22B.
RPCM.
To be here.
We have
send it. Why?
I think it's better to go because we have pressure load.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah.
No, 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 stop, stop. It's toxic.
Toxic.
Ammonia.
Oh, gosh, that means I
and,
have.
And no, nobody tells
us. Yeah, no,
it's not, it's not ammonia.
Because, oh, it's not ammonia.
No.
Oh. But
better you take a mask and go to.
Okay.
Okay. See you.
Bye. It's been fun.
Yes.
Alright, I'm gonna put pretend like I put the phone. Well, I haven't put the phone yet.
What you got
to do? You know what? We're executing the
joint emergency rescue cart. Joint emergency rescue cart. Okay. What do you want?
I want to make sure it's not ammonia. That's somebody
actually,
didn't forget to say
if, we, if, no.
If you don't hear it, okay. Alright,
yes.
А что они сказали?
Я думал, ее просто с собой таскать могу.
Kind of knocking on 6 and 1. You came in kind of soft. I heard everybody, all 6 crew members in ISS.
Michael, okay, for the medium side, we are here.
Yeah, I know.
We're here.
John respirators.
Okay.
Go ahead. Joshua, you ready? Yeah, we're good. Go ahead.
Okay.
These are wearing out.
Okay, Rocky.
Okay.
The samples came out in the dawn respirator range, and you have respirators on.
We've got 4 of the 6 of us on respirators. We're working on the last 2. We use 3 PPAs and 2 pressure tests.
I thought I was watching the movie.
Those three pictures? Yeah.
Can you ask Kim to release camera 37, please?
Do you have camera 37?
Stand up. did it before, actually.
Right? Sandy and I did it, and we moved it out to here.
Well, what do you hang on to out there? That's from the free
floater. I did it like a either a BRT or a waist tether here, and just was on the corner there and helped him move it around. So I think I may have BRT'd here, and I could reach up high enough where I could help him rotate.
Is there some open grids here you can push a foot into?
Yeah, you could if you want to. I think potentially there, but mostly I think I was BRT'ing.
Well, I guess the important thing is we need to know how to write the procedure. Right now we're doing it over here. We can do it here. Just stop them.
Yeah.
We need to know what to expect, so we can have
it. Yeah. Very low hover, and your head was right at the interface, too, so you could see that you weren't going to hit anything.
So you had a BRT on this?
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure I had a BRT,
so
had, yeah.
You could get kind of two hands
right.
on it from there.
Right, and so you could, I could get hands on it and help you rotate it. And
right.
By that point, I didn't have to worry about this anymore, so all you had to do is watch underneath, and you could see underneath that you had a good gap,
yeah.
And just slowly bring it over to you.
Born ready. Break a breaker, why not?
Up to you guys, Sandy, because I think it'd be fine from a DVA perspective. You can reach down there, just bring it close enough to reach down there, then basically waist under the arm and do your all your configuration that's hanging off the arm,
mm-hmm.
And then bring it, drag it back closer to you and get the ingress.
We'll wash the glass on the front of the window. Yeah, our first maneuver is Z.
Well, I'm GCA and I've built clearance, so
that's
what my point is.
Starting a little bit
stronger. I've got my hand up a little bit. Okay, that's too far away. Here, but I think I'm clean.
down in the asphalt pit here, so I can look down there and I can push the pump lines down.
Yeah, I think the only problem with going high, Mike, is that you can't verify that your side is down on the bottom. So you can push it down, you know, but my... Okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
I just wanted the Paso and 2-2 in Edwards.
Okay. So I guess 2-6 is open now.
So like I said, we'll be there. We'll be there sometime between this one and this one. So I think we'll be okay.
Yeah. Take a long runway.
Yeah.
Which is the right southern runway. Right?
It'd be the eastern. Yeah. Eastern. It's 3214.
The southeastern runway.
Yeah. All right. We need
All right, guys, we have a good one.
How about it?
7 feet. Kind of right on the edge there. And kind of hold right there.
These two tools are hard to find because people are usually using them.
Torque wrenches?
Yeah. Torque wrenches are out and about, even with just two of us. We were doing a lot of assembly, though. I don't know how much assembly we're doing. I'm not doing as much. Again. There should be several of these on board now.
This is the one you were talking about?
Not the tilty one, but the one that doesn't tilt. Yeah. Everybody should have their own ratchet and driver and socket head.
Right. Chris, this is the only torque wrench. Torque measuring device that actually limits the torque. Okay, the other ones just give you an indication. We talked about that in the other class where all you get is a click and it breaks away, right?
Yeah.
But that one will actually slip when it reaches the setting that you have it on.
The adapters.
To get these things
these
out,
are
just pulling this guy out and jamming it down in there is probably the easy way.
But if you want this one, you have to get this guy in and then swap it. Yeah, that's right. The easiest, that's the fastest way to do
right.
it. This is an upside down.
And of course, the torque wrenches, when you get done with them, you set them at the low setting and store them that way to relieve the pressure on the springs.
They don't.
Mm-hmm.
Just can't get your little finger down in there.
It's like a regular old basin wrench for a big basin.
Yeah, there's lots of fun toys in here, actually.
Is this a torque wrench? This looks the same,
yeah,
too.
That's a big torque wrench.
We have one of these. I won't shuttle, right?
Use that one.
It's not exactly the same.
Yeah, it's not that big, but it's very similar. That's for the CBM, for driving the CBM bolt.
I was using it for something else.
Really?
Driving the CBM bolt.
Yeah, it goes around the outer diameter.
Closing the door.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Right. One thing I wanted to mention on adjustable wrenches is, you know, you want to turn it towards the adjustable part, right? So if you're loosening something, then that means you're tightening it the other way. Assuming it's a right hand thread.
I never practiced that growing up.
And the reason for that is it, you know, with the slop that's in this thing.
Yeah.
It gets
a
little bit tighter.
If you go against it,
it's going to slip. So,
yeah.
But towards the adjustable job. The two things about these, Phillips is
like
pointier. Okay, so from the side, it's definitely pointier.
Definitely,
and then these wings on this are directly opposite
mm-hmm.
each other. Okay,
mm-hmm.
and those are offset. They call that an offset cruciform drive tip. Full ones on the last flight, but they wind up
a little bit.
You know, they wind up not actually. Well, and the problem with little ones is they're generally in the places you use those kind of screws are places that have real limited access, and so put it on something like that.
How would you make that?
And then to connect anything to that.
Yeah.
Commercial
tools.
We have those in the shuttle. This is just like
the
one in the big shuttle fan bit.
Yeah.
And likewise this guy. The robo grips are pretty cool.
They're rusty, really, really.
Yeah,
fine.
I bet they will. There's a good looking baby.
There you go.
Yeah.
Use this occasionally.
It's not just being shiny.
Don't do it, you're shiny. These are usually out and about.
What do we use this on station for, Sandy, besides?
I'm really crude.
Crew discipline.
Crew discipline works great.
Crew discipline.
And then this is kind of an interesting tool. If you've used one of these in the past, picking that up will be. Yeah, that one.
Oh my gosh, that's not heavy at all. What'd you guys?
It's funny, isn't it?
How's that?
The balance is all weird.
Look the other way.
It's crazy, yeah. No kidding.
Aluminum handle steel drums?
That's weird.
Yeah.
Used cautiously.
Yeah, I was going to say, really.
How many pipe fittings do you have on the station?
Not many.
But if you need one,
there you go.
Pipe fitters, you
got
to
have one.
Requirement.
Box.
Yeah. I like it. It's not that or something.
It's really easy when you're putting them back on orbit to have an angle on them. And actually, sometimes what happens is you'll be closing them and they tilt a little bit.
Yeah, and they get
jammed. So you gotta pull it out and straighten it up.
And the bag is, it's a CTB, right? Or half CTB. And it's got a bunch of stuff in it. A lot of the stuff that's in here really is
some of it. Some of it'll be sticking to the side and some of it won't be. So if you open up CTBs, be careful because sometimes things come out of it. Just in general.
Yeah, and we've got a lot of different kits in there. That's the, what is that, the tap and die kit?
Yeah.
Okay, hopefully you won't be using those, but they're there, a lot of stuff in there. Of course, the main thing you would probably use that for is if you have some threads that are kind of stiff and you need to clean them out, or a common term is to chase the threads. That's actually for the dies, so that's the tap handle there.
So that's for retreading a hole?
Yeah. Now, you could theoretically drill a new hole and put threads in it and make yourself a new threaded hole, but the chances of that are minuscule. I don't think we've done that. We have cleaned some threads out a little bit. This is a guy that, like you said, you've drilled some things out.
Yeah.
Is this the kit that you used?
Yeah, the problem I had was, I think some of these were not clear what was white band, like some of the markings were gone, and I ended up with the left-handed and I needed right-handed or something like that.
Okay.
I don't remember, but I figured it out and did it.
Guys, to bite into here and get that out, I've been successful with that in the past.
That's the next one that I saw.
Yep.
So you just drill it all the way through, is that what you did to get a screw up?
Sure.
I used one of these guys, I started drilling all the way through, then they said, well, use a left-handed bit and grab onto it.
Yeah. And the flutes on those.
Give me the little turbuckle with that, whatever that thing is called. What's it called? T-handle.
Tap handle.
Yeah. The flutes on those are designed to grip in a hole, right?
Yeah.
And if there's enough of a hole already because you strip the screw out, you might get lucky if you have the right size screw extractor for that. So on the ground, we're going to go through all kinds of gyrations trying to make sure that we give you the right things to use. You know, what you guys are able to go through a real-time evaluation kind of thing like this is really going to be where you get the answer, in my opinion. So, and we can charge these. We can't charge these on the ground, but this is what the batteries are. That's the one we're going to play with today.
The charger for that was in note 2. No, it was in note 1.
Solid.
Looking for the Makita, go to the
progress. And this
is straight. Well,
like you'll stall.
And my understanding is that's the one they use for the progress launch bolts because it's got the
like a drill,
the impact driving.
Yeah.
And they're loud, so it comes packed with earplugs over there.
Which
and
Russians,
right? The torque settings on that you're playing with are. There's no calibration to that, and we make no attempt to tell you what they might be. Other than the one that you just got to there with the charger, where it runs it through a, kicks it all the way down and then recharges it really. There's in the battery.
Talk about all those different substrates we've got. The large majority of the And here's a shot that shows the piles I was talking about earlier, the AET piles. That's not an area that we would ever go over here. We need to get back to you. So we don't think we're there. And then there's a few other piles I didn't mention earlier. Back here on the aft end, the GPS system is going to be high temperature. This is a real thin coating that's put on here. It's called a transfer coating. It's very thin, very evenly, carefully controlled layer that goes on there. That is what the tile is bonded to. So the tile is bonded to this RTV on the top. And then the whole thing, the tile, the sit pad on the bottom, or in the tile. So for instance, with a 6x6 tile, which is the standard size on the tiles, the sip would be 5x5. So that leaves you a little half inch gap around the edge of each one. 1 inch, and 20 inch one. What we'll do is they'll put a strip of the sip, the pillar bar rather, down at the bottom. That's going to be where the gap in the tile is. The pillar bar is basically the same material. That's what you see up here. Here's an untreated pillar bar. It's been heat treated, so it can withstand a little bit higher temperature. You got some of this stuff sticking up, especially for in the vehicle, because it can cause boundaries spreading out from where the transition occurs. So it's going to have turbulent flow behind it and have increased heating. So if you've got, you see, you've got actually a pretty fat gap between the tiles down here at the bottom. At the very top, they close that up so you don't have a lot of exposure. If you're white fabric in there, you're looking at that pillow type gap. And you'll mainly see that either on the aft part of the vehicle and in a few places far right on the forward part of the vehicle, around the nose, around the carrier panels on the forward RCS, places like that. The pure white substrate on it, that's the main thing that you can distinguish. The LI-900 is the only one that's got that really, really white, bright white substrate. You can see the RCG on the top, very thin. Lay that there if you guys want to take a look. And it's just, and it is glass. Shatter very easily. This is a white LI-900 tile, very same thing. You know, where it attaches to the sip, it just allows it to withstand higher stress levels. If you've got a point load in there somewhere, like just a rough spot in the RTV or the sip. They're just the virgin tile, LI-900, they can only withstand an 8 PSI load across that tile. This stuff, when it breaks off, it tends to come off real to be powdered, create a lot of debris, the LI-900 materials. The heavier substrates, the Fricke 12 and the LI-2200, because they're a more rigid substrate, they're going to be a whole lot loose material. And the stuff we take off, we've got a little sticky thing. I'll go over in class this afternoon how we do that. So we're trying to stick it, so we're not just blowing it out. So we don't expect a lot to get on the surface. It would be a concern coming back in. There's a pretty good chance if you think you got any on there. All these were considered good tiles on the fly. You can see, you know, there's evidence of heat scoring around the edge of this one. This gray stuff is pretty common. The more these tiles fly, the grayer they get. I've been told that it does not significantly change their emissivity, but they still perform as good as new tiles. I talked about the plasma getting down in between there, and this is a good example of that. You can see heat scoring, and you can see a little bit of charring, and you know, a few little points in here, that's where plasma is getting down on the side of this tile. You'll also notice all these tiles have got a little white circle on it. That's the waterproof mark. If you look closely in the center of that, you'll see a teeny tiny hole. All the tiles have to be waterproof. These things, the substrate is 90% void, or open space. You can see that one.
Yes. You can just tell it's a lot denser.
Yeah.
It almost feels like porcelain.
Yeah. Now, and it's interesting, that's the lightest tile that we find on the vehicle. That's an 8-pound tile. This is not high temperature material. So that's important to remember when we look at how the system all goes together. So now let's see. So the example, what we've got here, this is the thermal barrier. Right here it would be gray instead of this orange color like you see. It would not have this little strip of aluminum on it. It would look more like what you see down here. Otherwise, it would be, well, I guess it would have this. Now, the other thing you might want to notice on the door, this has got the curved tiles, kind of like I was showing you on the carrier panel, all the way around the door. So when the door closes, it's going to close up and just leave a little thin strip of exposed foam around the edge. Then further in, what you've got is this environmental seal. The environmental seal and the thermal barrier work together to prevent any plasma from getting down in here and burning, causing a burn on the The way that works, the environmental seal is actually the pressure seal of this door when it's closed. So when you're coming back in during re-entry, you got the same kind of thing on your main gear doors and your nose gear door. They're all going to have an environmental seal in here that's hitting a nice smooth surface.
I was having issues with the zippers today.
Is it? Oh, it's caught on some under. Okay. It's caught on some suit underneath it. Kind of a feel for what he was doing.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that was perfect. I liked it. Then I had to say when to get out of it.
It worked almost good.
testing wasn't in vain.
Grab a shot of cooler.
Grab a drink.
Okay.
Okay.
I got that.
I know.
You want to leave your CCA on or take it off?
Oh, wow.
Somebody tugging some washer. No, just need to know to move, not move.
All right, guys. Is everybody on that side? I'll just fuck you with this fucker. Out of your way.
Mm-hmm. You have a hang up?
I got hung up on my pressure thing just because I forgot. Yeah,
but that was actually really good buddy system. I saw the wreck.
Yeah, I beat Grimes. Yeah,
she did him. He's already up home, but he came back and moved it.
Great. I mean, the one thing is that you forgot to vent first off. It's just a bonus to vent. Not a hard requirement to vent, but it gives you that position, unlatch, and rotation, and then, so. But that brings up a good point. If you were at an EOS, you don't have ground support people, that is how we want you to get out of here. It might not be a mode 5 that you use in this lot. Maybe just for you to get out.
So that's the way we want a Tau. They're planning on us getting out.
No, Tau, we have support.
All right. Okay.
We have support on Tau.
It's ELS. Right.
Or TLS, we have support.
No,
ELS.
ELS.
You're going to have to babysit the vehicle. So.
That's the Tau.
There's one more thing that we don't have in mind today, but the two high intensity chem lights.
They disappear.
What is this
not
deactivated?
The only time you use them is mode 5. Start out and come through and end up sliding.
Because I'm not
going
to buy the mid deck, so it's going to be earlier. So is that okay?
And why do they last? Like 8 hours?
They last 8 hours.
Yeah.
12 hours typically.
But as soon as we get it.
Those will last 8 hours.
As soon as we
the high intensity ones will only last like 8 minutes.
We won't activate
them.
You won't activate them.
Available if you didn't use them going uphill,
yeah.
You could put them on the flight deck.
I think I might
do
that.
So
I'm not going to have a grand deck.
There's two spares. There's two pre-set up there right above the hatch on the left.
It all made sense.
This is attaching the hatch.
I showed it
to
Bernie and
he's
like,
huh?
You
got it.
I knew what she was doing.
Figured it out after a while. Well, there's no windows to put
in.
We were on the same wavelength, man.
Exactly.
Hey, yeah.
But before you get on the plane,
I'll get my phone.
Thank you. So I'm gonna lower your visor, lock it, but
and they'll help you.
Any questions?
Thank you. wherever you're looking. All right, guys, here we go. Chris, you're still looking a little more to the left. You should probably get a little bit more into the light. Sorry. It's going to kill you, but here we go.
He has one.
A
what?
Pencil or pen.
Okay.
It's got to come out of this kneeboard.
It's hard to tell whether it's the environmental lights or the section of the payload station.
Excellent.
Oh, just
somebody
one? Just came in and
this
moved
one's
it,
fine.
Which was great.
There's another one if you need it. Let's put that in a shoulder pocket. Just for now, yeah.
Okay. Is that it? And your car is good?
Yes, thanks.
All right, well,
you
okay?
Got your flight data file?
Got you locked. Clear
nice. Right. I haven't seen that at all. It should be outside still. Yes, we have books sitting on the table.
All right, Rich, you're all ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, Juan, we are ready. Okay, you guys got to get on that. We're all ready.
Right.
see if we can go the other way around.
Okay.
Thank you. John, so funny.
They can take one back to audit, right? What time do we need that?
About a minute and a half, maybe 2 minutes.
That's it.
Wow.
Oh, sure. All right, service feedback, please.
Take it back.
We see the 2234 on board. We'd also like you to pick up the payloads. You can restring at the Ops 3 transition per the cue card. Matt, done.
Thank you.
Oh, good so far, man. All
right, here's
it's
the
nice.
Ops 301 for
string one still down.
String one is going to be his back now, Mike. Okay.
But when we had, you know, I had him for 126 and. Hmm? I think I was a good luck with them. I don't remember having issues with them. If they were very minor.